the name of the one holy and living God. Amen. So for a long time, I used to listen to this gospel, and I would hear Jesus whispering in my ear, "Marianne, you're not doing your job." Because I would hear this gospel, and I would hear a direction that I am supposed to go out, start knocking on doors, and converting people to Christ. That's what a follower of Jesus does. And I know everyone here, I'm sure, has had that encounter where you open your door, and you are asked, "Have you been saved? Have you met your Lord and Savior?" Or some other very weighty question to be asked by a stranger. And I struggled with, am I supposed to be out there cold calling for Christ? Have any of you ever done any cold calling? It stinks. My first experience was in college. I wanted to get a second job to earn some more money. So this was when telemarketing was just kind of getting started. I was in Boston, and I had some friends who were going, taking the bus to Cambridge. And from 7 to 12 at night, would be doing telemarketing. And I'm an extrovert, and I was like, I can do that. So you go, you eat some free pizza, you get trained in an orientation, you're given the script, and then you put on those headsets. So I put on the headsets. I had no idea what I was supposed to be selling or doing. I can't remember that at all. I remember I took 3 calls. I took the headset off, put it down, gathered up my stuff, and left. I was like, I can't. There was nothing of me invested, and I felt completely like an intruder trying to insert myself into this person's private space. So I've prayed with this text a lot, trying to hear the good news and the challenge that Jesus offers. And I have to tell you, I'm starting to think of it much differently as I walk on my journey with Jesus. One of the first things I hear Jesus say to, by the way, did he send 12 of his disciples out? No, the number was a lot bigger, wasn't it? He sent out 70. So Jesus is sending out a lot of people that he hasn't had a lot of one-on-one time with, and yet he trusts them to go ahead of them, and he says this phrase, go on your way. This idea that God has enough faith in us, that we determine where it is we are to go and what our path is. Now, there's certainly lots of ways in which we can do a reality check on the way. Are we on the right path? I mean, Jesus gives us a lot of clues about what the way is. In our collect this morning, we prayed, oh God, thank you for teaching us that all of your commandments are summed up in love your neighbor as yourself. So that's some clue as to what the way means. We have a disciple in Jesus' ministry who says, Lord, Lord, how can I follow? I do not know the way. And Jesus says, oh, Thomas, you do, because you've seen it. It is the way of truth. It is the way of light. It is the way of life. When our values are in line with those values of God, we can know that we are walking on the right way. Yes, it is a narrow road, Jesus says. It's not the way of the world, those ways of love and truth and life. Jesus trusts us enough to find that path for ourselves. He also says to this group of 70, I send you out like lambs amidst the wolves. He does not say, onward, Christian soldiers, does he? What are some of the differences between a lamb and a wolf? A lamb is certainly the meeker of the two animals, right? Some would consider the lamb to be in the weaker position. And we hear Paul say, God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. It's not weakness the way the world thinks of weakness. It's vulnerability. It's openness. It's taking risks towards love, towards forgiveness, towards entering into difficult and challenging situations, believing that God is with you all the time. We heard this beautiful phrase, verse 8 of that psalm we just said, just caught my attention. God holds your soul all the day of your life. He will not let your foot be amiss. That belief that God is a part of every interaction is what says we're not weak. We are actually resilient and strong enough to be open to the challenges God puts before us. And finally, there's this attitude of hospitality that is throughout Luke's gospel and probably one of the most resonant themes of Christ modeling a life in God. Hospitality is not just taking and receiving food and drink. Hospitality is entering into a situation saying, peace be with me, peace be upon this house, peace be with the people I'm about to engage with. It's a very mindful awareness that there is something to be received in every exchange we have. The gift is in how we are converted in the relationship, not what we are bringing to the table. He is asking those followers to go out, enter a house, listen to their story. I did a very different type of cold calling that I'm sure you're familiar with, and I know you've all heard before, but everybody who's going to be a priest has to engage in what's called CPE, Clinical Pastoral Education. And it takes a variety of forms. I spent a summer at Beth Israel Hospital on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. And you make cold calls into hospital rooms, and you're assigned a floor, even waiting rooms, walking around with people in pre-op waiting rooms asking. I can't even tell you how terrifying. just think about the next time you're in a public space, walking up to strangers. And I mean, I was just like everybody else. What you want is you feel like you have to go into each situation being the expert. Because everybody's going to want to know, is there life after death? Is God really present? Why isn't my healing? And you're not going to have any answers, because we all know there aren't really answers to a lot of those questions, right? So I had an Orthodox rabbi was my supervisor. And all he wrote when he was sending us out into the floor, he put on the blackboard, don't hide your light under a bushel basket. You have something. It's the light in you. God's given it to you. Walk into each room. Peace be with you. And simply ask people their story. Why are you here? To listen to another human being, to give them the privilege of your time and attention, is an incredible gift. And I know many of you, all of you, have experienced this from both sides of that conversation, right? And those times in which you have entered into it and you leave and you're transformed. Something has changed in your heart because of the story this person shared, because God placed you and that person in relationship for some period of time. That's why I think the disciples return rejoicing. Jesus leaves and he says, I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. Those disciples returned rejoicing, not because they said, hey, we converted 50 sinners, but because they have experienced that faith and trust that God put them on their way. They were open to new experience and they heard something that touched their hearts. Jesus says, it's not about what you do. It's not about the number of souls you converted. Don't worry about the things you've seen. Know that God is with you. That's where your reward is. That newfound awareness of Christ and God's presence in your life. So that's the good news and the challenge I hear in this morning's gospel. Not that we are called to go out and cold call for Christ or convert other people. Hearts are converted by God. And they are converted when people see the love of God that radiates through welcoming, open, and transformed hearts. Amen.